Welcome to the Bridge. We're glad you could join us tonight. Jesus is our bridge between God and man. He came and he serves as our bridge. And now we're trying to be his bridge to others, to our community. We're trying to bridge our head and our heart together. We're trying to bridge God with people. We're trying to bridge grace and truth. Truth alone can be very legalistic and harsh, but grace alone can be very licentious and loosey-goosey. We're trying to be loving and truthful and work that out. And we're glad you could join us tonight. And I guess we're bridging between doo-wops and traditional Christmas. We had a little bit of fun there. I was like, who approved this opening song? You don't even know, right? That was a lot of fun. Well, there's something about that too, right? Bridging the fact that we're really serious about our relationship with God. We think it really makes a difference in life not to go through life on our own, but to do it with a God who cares about us and loves us and came for us on Christmas. And yet we balance that with having a lot of fun. I mean, if anyone should have a little bit of joy, a little kick in their step, and have a little bit of fun, and a little hot chocolate later, and a few cookies, I think we should be able to do that. Tonight, we are finishing up a kind of a series. We've been in a series of passages the last 4 or 5 weeks called A Checkered Christmas. And so finally, I could pull my checkered jacket out and work it all together. And a few people said, well, what are you going to do for refreshments? Well, I got it covered. There's a Chex Mix out there for you. So like it all coordinates. It's all symbolic. What does a checkered person mean? Usually we think, well, he has a checkered past. She has a checkered history. It's usually they have an iffy, like something's not totally right. They're a little bit maybe morally lost a little bit or have done some cuckoo stuff. And what we're finding in the scriptures that's so shocking is that Jesus came for checkered people.
Amen.
Amen. Not only people with a checkered past, but a checkered present, and by the way, a checkered future. In other words, he came for people who really don't have it all together, but want to have a relationship with God. And a lot of people are confused. They think he came for religious people, and the goal is to be very religious. Well, I don't think he has anything against religion, but the Romans had a lot of beliefs and a lot of gods, and the Greeks already had that too. And the Jewish nation was enamored with all kinds of religious rituals and temple worship and liturgy and candle lighting. And yet Jesus came on Christmas morning to say, even if you light every candle, even if you tithe, even if you go to church every week, put a fish sticker on your car, it's not going to do it. God wants a relationship with you.
Amen. Amen.
He wants to know you personally. So Jesus came to like, you who... He wants to know you personally and wants it to be personal and relational and eternal. And what shocks people, we read the Christmas story in Luke chapter 1 and 2, but then we got into Luke 5 and Luke 7, Luke 9, Luke 10. Today we got up to Luke 19. All these little episodes where Jesus comes in contact with someone and each time he points out to them, I didn't come for the religious, I came for people who want a relationship with God. I didn't come for people who think they're in right standing in their own goodness. I came for people who realize I'm never going to be totally good enough. I need a good God who will be gracious, loving, and forgiving. And so today we had a good time looking at that as a passage. So today you'll just get a little nugget. I'm just going to give you a few verses as we close out our series. But it's all about if you feel a little checkered, you're welcome. We're glad you're here because you belong. And Jesus came for you. He didn't come for the healthy, he said. He came for the sick. He didn't come for the people who think they had it all together. He came for the people who didn't have it all together. He came for shepherds. Do you know the reputation of a shepherd in the first century?
Yeah.
Wayne, it wasn't very good, was it? No, it wasn't good. In fact, he wasn't even born in a major place, right? In fact, even Mary and Joseph had a hard time finding a hotel room. Not even a Motel 6 was available. Like, can you do the cattle stall? So we brought the animals in. It's just a reminder. What kind of God would be born in a manger, come in human flesh, like not worry about? He could have come at any age he wanted on lightning bolts and lit up the sky. Which he will when he comes back, by the way. But the first time he came approachable, Mary and Joseph were no-name people. They weren't rock stars in the first century, just everyday, ordinary people. And he loved prostitutes. He loved tax collectors. He loved the religious and the irreligious. He loved the people that are really working hard and the wackadoodles who are losing it. He made an invitation for everyone. It's like, if you want to know God personally, you can come. So tonight we're celebrating that. We're going to sing Angels We Have Heard on High, which is really, really fun. We've got a couple solos for you, a real simple service, but we're just here to remind you, if you have it all together, we're not going to be very impressive for you because we don't. But if you feel checkered and in process and part of the journey, welcome. You're going to fit right in because that's the God we have. He didn't come for religious people. He came for people who have a heart. In the story of the Good Samaritan, which we taught just a couple weeks ago, guy gets hurt on the road, and you know, a priest comes by and everyone's like, oh, the priest will help. And it's like, nope, he cuts across to the other side. Oh, a Levite comes by. He's really religious. He'll help. Nope, he cut across to the other side. They were so religious, they didn't want to be defiled, and maybe the guy was dead, and I didn't want to be contaminated, and they got all religious. And then a Samaritan, that's like an SC grad for me. Oh! I do love my SC friends, but as a UCLA grad, it's shocking to hear a Samaritan was used by God. Oh, now he does the fight song with, oh. What is this? This is a lot of hostility in the room. Do you know the UCLA fight song?
No, I don't.
No, you don't.
I know the Northridge fight song, but not the UCLA.
Oh,
God.
Oh, man.
Ay, 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 ay. No, I did not. Oh, gosh. Next year's theme will be blue and gold, just for if you can join. Anyways, a Samaritan comes by and helps him, and Jesus tells this religious guy, who do you think was the neighbor? Who do you think was the loving guy? And the guy's like, I guess the guy who helped out. Yeah, the Samaritan. Because it doesn't matter if you go to UCLA or SC. It doesn't matter if you go to temple, you don't go to temple. It doesn't matter if you go to church, you don't go to church. If you don't have love in your heart, you miss it. Love is the great commandment. That's why he came. That's what we're known by. And Jesus always kind of reduced us away from the religious and towards the relational. And so if you're here and you want to love God and love people, you're in the right place. Speaking of alma maters, Brady's here. Brady's my nephew. This is my brother, his wife, their two sons and daughter. And Brady was the quarterback at Memphis, and they played yesterday in a bowl game, and they lost at the last second, but it wasn't because of Brady. He had an amazing scramble with like 2.5 minutes left. And how long was that pass that you used? Like, come on, 45 yards maybe or something? Is like something like that, yeah. And it's like, oh my gosh, Memphis is coming back. They're like within the 20-yard line, and then we got 32 seconds, and it's coming down. And then with, I don't know, maybe 16 seconds, you throw a zinger right to the wide receiver on the goal line, and he dropped it. But that's not your bad, my friend. That's not yours. And there's forgiveness for the receiver. That much forgiveness. No, it's fun to have family here. But whether you're SC, UCLA, Memphis, wherever, you know, you are loved by God. And you're in a safe place tonight. So tonight's real simple. We're going to greet one another. We're going to sing one song. We're going to have a couple solos, a teeny little nugget. We're going to light a couple candles, and that's it. And then we'll go. Does that sound good? Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, thank you for tonight. Thanks for who you are. Thanks for giving us the freedom to have fun because you're a loving God and you care about us, and we're really, really grateful for that. And, you know, in the midst of all the holiday hoopla, I'm so grateful these folks here have just taken a little pause for just an hour to say, you know what? I want to thank you. We want to give you due. We want to honor you because you're God and you came for us. It's really, really cool. And it's in your name we pray, and everyone said, amen. Do you want to just stand and say hi to someone real quickly, and then we'll get ready to sing?
Mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strength. Oh, Shepherds, wild is jubilee. Why your joyous strains prolong? What the gladsome tidings be, which inspire your heavenly song?
Grab a seat. That's awesome. Well, we've been talking about a checkered Christmas, and today, this morning, we got to look at Luke 19, which is a story about Jesus kind of making his way to Jerusalem, and he comes across this guy, Zacchaeus. And if you're a kid who grew up with Christmas, not Christmas stories, but Christian stories, this is Zacchaeus is a Roman head of the tax collecting branch. He's the head of the IRS, basically, in the first century. And he wants to see Jesus, but what's wrong with him? He's really short. Yeah, and Scripture points that out. Isn't that terrible? The guy's really a midget. He's teeny, teeny. So he climbs up into a tree to see him. And, of course, he doesn't want to be seen, but he wants to see this Jesus guy. And Jesus gets up to where he's at, and he literally says, Zacchaeus, get down. Come on down. It's like, oh, my gosh. He's horrified he's spotted. Two, Jesus knows his name, and they haven't met. Which is interesting, right? And when you're the head of the IRS and the deep state in Rome, you have a bad reputation because you swindle people out of a lot of money. And in that day, it was a lot easier to do than even today. And so when Jesus says to Zacchaeus, I want to be at your home today and we're going to like hang out and stuff, everyone else started to mutter. Why is he having a meal with a sinner? Like, why is he hanging out with someone who's not very religious? Why is he hanging out, you know, with someone who like has a bad reputation, a checkered history? And Jesus shares with the crowd the reason he came on Christmas morning. I came to seek and to save the lost. He came to seek. He's here to come after us. And he wants to save us from ourselves. You know, the most likely person to ruin your life is you, right? Everyone's tracking with that. I mean, there's a lot of crazies out there that might want to try to ruin it too, but you're the most likely. Certainly, I've been trying to ruin mine several times over, apparently. It can happen. But right before we get to the story we did this morning, in Luke 18, there was another passage, and I saved it for tonight. It's real short, but it's a few verses. Let me read it to you. It's in Luke 18. You don't have to turn there or anything, but if you have a platform and you'd like to follow along, I'm in Luke 18, verses 9 through 14. And Jesus tells this story about these two guys. Of course, again, one is very religious, and one isn't. So here goes. To some who are confident of their own righteousness and look down on everyone else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray. One's a Pharisee, religious. The other is a tax collector. Verse 11, the religious Pharisee stood by himself and he prayed, God, I thank you that I'm not like other people, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, even like this, tax collector. Why, I fast twice a week, and I give a tenth of all that I get. Verse 13, but the tax collector, well, he stood at a distance. He wouldn't even look up to heaven, but he beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me. A sinner. And now Jesus says, I tell you that this man, the tax collector, rather than the other, the religious one, went home justified before God. For all of those who exalt themselves will be humbled, but those who humble themselves will be exalted. Let me go back and do those verses one more time. Let's go back to verse 9. He says, to some who were confident, you might just put there like cocky, right? Arrogant in their own righteousness, their own goodness. They thought they had it together. They were enamored with their own moral performance, their own. They were satisfied with how religious they thought they were. And therefore, they looked down on everyone else, of course, in very smug ways. I mean, they don't even go to church. I mean, you know, pagans, heathens, right? They looked down on others. They had a low, scornful regard for everyday, hardworking people. Well, to those people, Jesus told them a parable, a little story. Verse 10. Two men went to the temple courts to pray. One was a Pharisee. That's the religious Jewish leader. And the other is a tax collector. Boo! You could hear it in the first century, like, ooh, IRS, deep state. This is a despised guy, particularly by the Jews, because they hated being controlled by the Romans, let alone taxed by them, and heavily taxed at that, and known for their dishonesty oftentimes. Verse 11. Well, the Pharisees stood up. You know, he stands up erect, well, almost like he's posing, I suspect. And he prayed, really about himself, right? God, a little self-centered prayer. God, I just thank you so much, Lord. I'm just so grateful that I'm so good and not like other people, like these robbers and evildoers and adulterers and immoral and scumbags and lowlife and trailer trash and this tax collector that I'm just so hung up on how good I am. I just think I'm just so special. I am your gift to the world. Okay, maybe the accent didn't help. I don't know. I don't know how. It's not in my notes. It just started to go there. I don't know. I'm so sorry. If you're Southern and you're like, he totally, that was terrible. Okay, I appreciate your grace. Let's go to verse 12. He continues. He's basically saying, look at me. I fast. Go without food like twice a week, usually on Mondays and Thursdays in the ancient world, and I give faithfully a tenth. That's I tithe of everything I get. I mean, I'm a rule keeper. Like, I keep the rules. Like, you're gonna love. I'm the best student. Well, okay, so that's part of the story. Let's go to verse 13. Now we have the tax collector. Boo. But the tax collector, he actually stood at a distance, some measure away, probably like back in the shadows. Like, he's a little embarrassed. Like, he's not a religious guy. He doesn't like get all the special righteousness stuff. He doesn't know the rules of goodness in the first century. So he stands at a distance and, he wouldn't even look up to heaven. I mean, basically that's the scripture saying he dipped his head. I mean, his eyes were, I mean, he's kind of like, okay. Here's the guy with all the titles, and then there's me. He even beat his breast, pounded his chest, which was a gesture of like sorrow, remorse in the first century, even like despair. Like, ugh, it's like going, I'm a loser. It's like, oh, God. I mean, I have no credentials. I don't deserve. I don't earn. Anything, right? If anything, I'm going to ask, please have mercy. Like, I am falling on your compassion, your propitious nature, your good favor, because I'm a sinner. Like, I go astray. I miss the mark. I blow it. Okay, so we have the religious guy and the tax collector. What does Jesus say? Verse 14. He says, I tell you that this man, the honest, self-acknowledged, sinful tax collector, rather than the other completely unaware, self-righteous, religious Pharisee, he's the one who went home justified before God. Justified means made right with God. He's the one that was accepted and approved by God. The one acquitted of his sins, accounted as free from guilt. He's the one who's really made right with God. And then he sums it up this way. And it's not overly spiritual language here. He just says, if you want to exalt yourself, set yourself up as God's gift to the world, make yourself the high one, just a heads up, you're going to get humbled. Whatever you think you're getting away with now, looking down on people, your day will come. But whoever is humble, like he humbles himself, he voluntarily chooses to take the way of the servant and the humble, the gracious, the kind, trust me, in due time, he's going to be exalted. He's the one who's going to get raised up. This is our word from God. This is God's word to us for this evening. We've been talking about a checkered Christmas. And I think Jesus is saying, if you think you don't have anything checkered to deal with, well, we're sorry, you missed it. But if you know that you don't have it all together, you may try hard, and we all do. We want to please God, and our good, noble deeds are as best we can do as like a thank you note to God. But they don't earn favor with God. There's not enough we can do to earn favor with a perfect, holy God. So we got to stay humble. We didn't come into the world with anything, and by the way, we're not going to be taking anything with us. So if you have a friend, you're fortunate. If you have a home or a car or something, if you have clothes on your back, food to eat, you're fortunate. Stay humble. God will lift you up. He came to seek and save the lost. He came on Christmas morning as approachable as you can be, lived a human life so you could relate to him. He wasn't highfalutin. He could be out there with the cow without a right ear. Okay, when this came down and he handed it to me, I'm like, something happened in the back. I don't know. He had an ear earlier today, but that's who he came for. All of us who are missing something. Something's broken. Well, if you're here and you know him, I hope you continue to just stay humble and affirm and say, thank you, Lord. Thanks for just another Christmas. I know some of you have had a horrendous year. It's been a very difficult, challenging year. It doesn't matter if you're dealing with cancer or losing a home or losing a job or just something didn't quite go right. Then I hope you just stay low and let God kind of raise you up and let him fill your spirits. If you're having a great year, fantastic. Share the goodness. But no matter what, Jesus came for you. And you may not even feel like he knows you. But trust me, if he knows Zacchaeus and they've never met, he knows you. And he's coming after you. And he's knocking at the door of your life, always saying, I want to know you. I want to know you. We're going to hear Charlene sing Sweet Little Jesus Baby Boy. And so come on up. We're going to hear that as I pray. We're going to bring in our manger. Jesus is the source of light. Notice when little Jesus came in, I got to turn our lights on. Just a little symbolism, right? The light comes from him. It doesn't come from being religious and doesn't come from going to church. Comes from God's love being in our hearts and letting him kind of illuminate us. So we're going to bring our cradle in with lights, and we're going to sing Silent Night, and then eventually we'll pass out some candles. It's a candlelight service. And thanks to the fire warden and everyone else, they're not real candles, so there you go. But they're symbols, right? And so I'm like, we'll do it. That's fine. We'll stick to fire code, but we get the symbol. Jesus is the light of the world, and he wants to spread that light. So let me pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this time. Thanks for your word. Thanks for coming so approachable. Thanks for tolerating us who aren't terribly religious, but we do love you and we want a relationship with you. And thanks for making way for anyone, whether tax collector or sinner. Anyone could have a relationship with you. Even when you died for us on the cross, it was the thief on the cross, who at the last moment cried out, Lord, please remember me, have mercy on me. And Jesus said, it's not too late. Even you will be with me in paradise this very day. So we thank you for that, Lord, and thank you for loving us this Christmas. And it's in your name we pray. And everyone said, amen.
Amen. Jesus, boy, they made you be born in a manger. Sweet little holy child, didn't know who you were. Didn't know you'd come to save us, Lord, to take our sin away. Our eyes were blind, we could not see, Lord. We didn't know who you were. Long time ago, you were born, born in a manger, Lord, sweet little Jesus boy. The world treats me mean, Lord, treat you mean too, but that's how it is down here. Jesus, we don't know who you are. You have told us, Lord, and we are trying. Master, you have shown us how, even when you were dying. Just seems like we can't do right. Look how we treated you. But please forgive us, Lord. Didn't know it was you. Sweet little Jesus boy, born a long time ago. Sweet little holy child, we didn't know who, no, we didn't know who you were. Thank you, Lord.
Am I on? Testing, 1, 2, 3. No. No problem. Just look, I need as much grit and gumption as I can get. I already sound like Mickey Mouse. Come on, can you make it sound? There you go. Do you know that song? Why it's something about leaving heaven. The leaving heaven song. Can you do that? Because I'm just like, I don't. It's coming to me now. We're celebrating Christmas. And we're starting to get into these final songs, Silent Night, Holy Night, but I think that song really ties together the purpose of the scriptures we've been looking at. We've been looking at the life of Christ, and each time he's pointing out, why did he leave heaven? Why did he actually come, and he came for you? And then we, are you okay doing that?
Sure.
That's awesome. So listen to the lyrics here. We're going to pass some buckets, kind of like the manger, little buckets. And if you want to give tonight, you're welcome to do that. But your presence here is our gift. This is not a financial opportunity for us. This is something just normal people that attend with us regularly have an opportunity. Sometimes they like to give a Christmas gift. There's no pressure. Like, that's God's given us, he's blessed us. But they're going to pass those buckets if you want to put a note in there or a prayer request or something, you can during this song. But this song has something about our worth. If we question our worth, we got to remember Jesus came for us, right? Doesn't it say something like that? It's cool. Let's play it.
Well, it's been real nice living way up here. Paradise over the atmosphere, but I can't stay long, gotta make my way. I'm leaving heaven today. You see, the world is dark and it needs a light. I'm gonna hang a star in the eastern sky, so everybody's gonna know where I touch down. I'm leaving heaven right now. I'm gonna walk around that broken what you're worth, well, you should know that you're the reason why I'm leaving heaven. Gonna be no kingdom, ain't gonna be no crown, just a little old manger in a little old town. But it'll do just fine for this humble king. I'm leaving heaven, let all the angels sing. I'm gonna walk around that broken earth, trading in these streets of gold. So if you ever wonder how much you're worth, well, you should know that you're the reason why I'm leaving heaven. My time comes to an end. I laid down my life like a truest friend. And when I get back home, I'm gonna make some room. So don't you worry, 'cause I'm coming back for you. And you will say goodbye to that broken earth. You're gonna walk on streets of gold. And if you ever wonder what my love is worth, well, you should know that I'm the reason you'll be seeing heaven. Well, you're the reason why I'm leaving heaven. Na, 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 na. I'm leaving heaven. Na, 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 na.
Good song. I love that song. That's fun. He was in heaven. He didn't have to come. Christmas morning was not the beginning of Jesus. He always was. It was the beginning of him coming for lost sinners. It was the beginning of him coming in human flesh to love us. Let's sing Silent Night together. And I need some helpers. Can some of you kids help me? We got to like light this room up. It's way too dark in here. And if you can help me pass some of these out to people, that would be awesome.
Thank you.
Amen. Look at those lights. I love it. These are a symbol. The light of the life, yes. The light of the world is Jesus Christ. He came on Christmas morning. He existed before that. But as Mark, thanks for singing that for us, he left heaven for us. And as we look throughout the Gospel of Luke, he came for checkered people, people that didn't have it all together, people who just knew they needed a Savior, knew that they needed God's love and forgiveness. And if that's you, it's certainly me, then welcome. When we leave tonight, as I close us out, we'd love for you to return these if you'd like. We have a bucket out there. And in that bucket, we got an exchange for you. We got a gift. If you haven't received a Bridge mug before, then we want to mug you. We just want you to know we love you. So you can turn the bottom when you turn it in, and you can turn your light in, and then that light better just shine inside your heart, and then you can just take a mug and say, I got mugged at the Bridge. Let me close this as we pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for a special night. We've sung a few carols, had a little bit of fun, we laughed, we built the nativity set and reminded ourselves, wow, you were with cows and camels and like outdoors. There was no room in the inn, but you came for us. You didn't need it fancy, and you didn't need it religious. You wanted people who had hearts, like the Good Samaritan. You came for lepers. You touched the untouchable. You came for people that others would scorn. You came for every one of us. And so tonight we get ready for Christmas Eve tomorrow, and then Christmas Day, where we celebrate you and say, thank you for coming. Thanks for including me. Thanks for saving me. And I pray this light becomes more real for you and in your heart tonight and this week than any other year of your life. No matter what the external circumstances are, I pray inside you a light shines. And you have God's love and grace and peace. And it's in your name we pray, Lord. And everyone said, amen. Mark, what do we want to wish these folks? Merry Christmas
Easter,
or something?
What
Easter
time
or something?
Is this?
Okay, you know this one, so you can join us.
We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Good tidings we bring to you and your King. Good tidings for Christmas and a Happy New Year. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Good night, everyone. We love you. Get your mug. Refreshments, coffee, donuts, cookies, tea, hot chocolate.